Hey, what's up, guys? I am Joe from Workbench, and this week we're going to talk about how to generate graphs based off of CSV data.
All right, so we're going to be making a graph kind of like this thing, and it's all driven with a CSV. If you're unfamiliar with that, it's just a text file, basically. CSV stands for comma-separated values. They look kind of like this thing over here. So you can see we have basically a title. So we have date, comma, subs, and then we have a date, and then we have a number for how many subscribers we have gained in that month. And that's actual YouTube data on this thing about how poorly we've done over this duration from our height in, what is this, March of 2018. Apparently in March of 2018, we became pretty uncool. And then right about January of this year, we were almost getting cool again. And then, yeah, we just didn't. So anyway, this is all built, again, off of that CSV. This whole graph, all of the data points from this come from that. All of these like title things on here all come from that CSV and an expression. If we turn this source text expression off, you can see we have nothing in that text layer other than that. So let's take a look at this, and we will look at how this thing is built.
As always, if you want more in-depth information about this project, you can grab the project file from our website for $1.
So the difference between this one is we've selected a different date range. And so since this one is a little bit more complicated, we're going to take a look at this particular one versus the whole entire graph. All right, so you can see in here I have a controller layer, and that basically has a range. So we're looking at these things, and this CSV, basically these are kind of like a database with rows. So the first one is pretty much ignored. It's just the heading. It just determines like which column is which. So we're going to start this thing here at row 1, and we're going to end at row 11. So that's going to give us 10 rows. The first row is actually 0, so we could really do this 0 to 10, I think. I'm not really sure why I set it up that way, actually, so let's leave it like that. You can see these are keyed. So basically, as we go through here, they change. That gave us new keyframes, so let's undo that real quick, and we'll move over to here, and we'll set that to 0 and 10. I'm not sure why I made that 1 and 11. I don't know why. Maybe there was an error in the way I had this coded to begin with or something. But this is 0 indexed, so the first row is 0. So you can see in here, I have this CSV file, which you just drag into your project just like normal. You can import it like any other file. I don't think this doesn't have to be in here at all in the way that this one's set up. I left it in here just so we can kind of see what the structure of this thing is.
If you need more of a primer on how to use CSV data inside of After Effects, check out Sergey's video over at Ucromedia. I'll leave a link down in the description below.
So let's open this up, and you can see that we have this little data thing here. And then we have date and subs, which were our headings from that CSV file. And you can see here we have date 0, and it has an expression on here. If you need any of this data directly, you can just copy this. And as you can see, it doesn't have like this comp.layer or whatever. It's just footage. So you get the footage and you get its data value. In this case, this one is 0 because it's the first column, and this is 0 for the first row. So the first value of everything under date will be 0. If for some reason you need to know how many are in this entire thing, there's a number of rows thing on here. For some reason, this can't be accessed as footage. It has to be accessed by a layer. So bear that in mind if you care about how many rows are actually in this thing. I'm hard coding these sliders, so I don't really care what the maximum value is. So what's really neat is you can go in at any point and save a different value to the CSV and it'll update. I haven't tried that live before, but let's say it's, 900. Oops, don't put that there. We'll save. Click back over here. You might have to actually update it. I don't know, it updates itself. See, so now it starts higher, but that would be a lie. So let's go back. We only had 241 subs gained in 2017. 01. So go back in here. The change is back. Perfect. CSVs are pretty awesome. So let's open up Expressionist over here, and we're going to take a look at this first one, which is the text, source text in months. And you can see we're grabbing a start and end slider from that controller layer, and then we're going to make a blank string appropriately called str. And then we have another object here, basically options. And then we have month, short, year, two digit. And this little piece basically is so we can format our dates down here. Thankfully, again, the new JavaScript engine lets us do cool stuff like that, so we don't have to like parse it ourselves. So then we just have a loop, and we're going to do for I equals start while I is less than end, I plus plus. So this for loop is going to basically grab all of the rows that we have in our CSV for the range that's defined by those two sliders. So we're going to set D equal to new date, and then we have that footage subs thing here. And then the data value is going to be 0 because we want the date column, and then I, which is going to be wherever we are in this loop within that range. this adding a negative one thing, it's not really adding a negative one, because if we go back to our CSV, which is something I conveniently closed, so let's open that up again. And basically, you can see we have here 2017-01. This is basically all I wanted to put in there when I wrote this thing. And while I could have written this thing as January 17, February 17, whatever, a lot of code-based things can use this kind of formatted date better. And there's like a weird bug or something that, depending on how you have this set, because this is like a standardized date format, it's like the year, month, day, it won't account for like your time zone, or it does somehow, I guess. And what happens is if you don't have this one at the end to say that it's like January 1st instead of just January, it subtracts like your offset of time, I think the actually time from your machine, probably from like the UTC time. And so you end up like a date behind. So this kind of specifically says like, this is the first day of the month. And also of note, the fact that I have this 01 in here, which is how it should be generally, if this was just one, that would also work. For some reason, putting this 0 in here messes it up. And if you put a 0 here, it'll also mess it up. So that's why there's no 101 here. It's very convoluted, but that's what it is. So this basically sets up a new date object with whatever date that is. So the 1st of January 2017 in this case. And so then to our original string that was empty, we're going to concatenate by doing plus equals. And we're going to use D, which is that date dot to locale date string. And in this case, I'm using en-us. And then I'm using the options, which we defined up here. So in this case, we'll have the month, and then we'll have the year. Short month, two-digit year. And then at the end of that part of the string, we're going to concatenate two tabs so that we have some spacing in between here. Now, if you notice, as we go through this thing, they kind of shift around, and that just depends on where the tabs fall. So it's not actually an even amount of space in between every one of these things. Since we're using the same number of letters, you can probably just use a monospace font so that doesn't jump around so much. Another alternative would be to set each one of these things up as its own individual text layer so that they really can't move, but I just didn't care that much. So anyway, so the next thing that we're going to look at, we're going to take this graph itself, and it has a very similar expression. So we're going to bring this up here, and you can see most of this stuff is the same thing, except if we look in this controller up here, there's also a tangent radius, and that's kind of what curves this stuff. There's another way you can do this where if we turn this guy off right here, because this is the one that I wanted to do because I liked it a little bit better, you could just graph these things as regular points, and then you could do a round corners here. Sorry, it's kind of hard for me to see it the way I have to sit at this gigantic monitor. But you can see this kind of smooths it out, and you know, it's just, it's nice or whatever. It's quick, just a quick and easy way to do it. But I kind of like having the control of the tangents, because if I want to, I can go to this controller. I can change it to kind of whatever I want. I can even go backwards if I really want to, and that gets funky. But you can go this way, you can make it like whatever you want. So it's kind of an interesting way to do it. Let's go back to where I had it, which was 50. So it's just a way to have a little bit more control. So anyway, we're bringing that slider in as well. So that's the only other thing we have in here. So you can see I've hard-coded these values for X and Y. And because I was lazy, I subtracted this offset from the actual layer itself, because you have to get the values right for where this needs to fall. So you have to subtract 96540, which is half the size of your comp. So here I wanted this to start at 296. So I brought out some guides if you saw in the previous comp. And in this case, I'm lining up with these dots in this grid I made in the background. And if we look over here, it's around about 296. So I have 296 minus 960 for the X position. And then I brought this down here to the zero, which is 763.7, which is 766 originally the way I did it. And then we're subtracting 540 from that, and that's our X and Y. So basically, we're starting with this corner over here.
If you're feeling adventurous, you can use nulls in the corner of where you want the graph to be to kind of set the bounds of it. I believe you can also access guides now via expressions, so that might be something to look into as well. It's homework.
So then, like we've done in the past, we're going to set up points equals a new array, in tangent equals a new array, out tangent equals a new array, and then we're going to loop. So we're going to do for I equals start, I is less than end, I plus plus. That looks kind of familiar, doesn't it? So we're going to set up a variable point x equals, and in case you're wondering, the reason that I need that is our x and y here are an offset. So I can't set those variables to something else because I need them. So to that x value that we have up here, we're going to take I minus start, because we need the first value to basically be zero. So if we're starting at like 6 instead of 0, we want to subtract that start value originally, so that the first value will be 0. That way we land at our original x position. So we're going to take that value, and we're going to multiply it. In this case, it's 147.7 distance between each one of these things, pretty much. This is probably a terrible frame to have stopped it on, so we'll stop over here because this is a little nicer. If you're curious, I got that value basically by drawing another guide out here to the end and then dividing this by, I think, 9 because we have 10. So then our next thing is point Y. We're going to take our Y offset value here. So this Y is at this level. And to that, we're going to subtract because we want to go up with our graph as it gets higher. And we're going to do linear of that footage, the new data value. And this is of 1 because we're wanting to know the actual number of subs this time. And as we're in the range here, we want to go I. So I will be whatever month we are in the range. And then we're going to go as it goes from 0 to 3,000 subs. We're going to go from 0 to 452. And 452 here is the maximum up at this top. And as you can see, we never actually hit that. So then our next line over here is points.push. We're going to append to that points array a point, point X, comma point Y. And those are in brackets because we're putting an array into an array. So we're going to have an array of arrays. And then in this case, because we only need the tangents to go basically horizontally, that makes it pretty easy. We're going to do intan.push, and we're going to do negative tan radius, so tan R, comma 0. And then outtan is going to get the same kind of thing, except for it's not negative. If you really wanted to, you could also sit here and actually just write this out with a bunch of values. They're the same thing because obviously, as you can tell, this doesn't change at all, but I figured just do it in the for loop that we got going and we're all set. So then the last line here, we have create path. I'm going to do points, comma intan, comma outtan, and false means that it is not going to be a closed shape. So we won't have a stupid line coming from here to here. And again, as we've done in the past, even if you don't want these to actually have that curve, instead of passing it like intan, where we would just do an empty array, which does not have that extra piece in the end. So there you go. You would pass that for both of these parameters because that's the only way you can get enough arguments in here to be false at the end. I'm going to undo that just so you can see it.
And if you're feeling lazy, like pretty much any good coder, you can grab the code from our website. Just use the project file link.
The only other thing that uses any of that stuff is this 2019 is actually animated. And that's done very similarly. While we're at it, we might as well pull that up. Let's hit EE. Bring the source text up here. All we care about in this case is the end year. So we're just going to grab the end slider that we have. Our options is just going to contain the year. And numeric means we're going to get a 4-digit year instead of the one that was 2-digit. This date object is set the same way. So we have 0, comma, end, because it's the date and the end of the range that we're looking at. And then we add that dash 1. I'm not going to say negative 1 because it's a dash. And I just set a variable year, and it does the same thing. 2 locale date string, ENUS options, same deal. Text.source text. Then we're going to concatenate year. And then we're going to concatenate a parentheses back there. And all of this text up to the first parentheses is basically hard-coded in here, and then that 2019 is added from here, and that parenthesis close deal is from there. And that's how that whole thing is set up. The rest of this is all pretty much just simple stuff. We have a grid set up in the back, and it has a slightly lighter background just because I wanted to do something a little bit where you can kind of see it in here. And this grid is set up in here with a grid. Obviously, our width is 147.7, so that matches that gap that we set for our graph. The height, I just made it 25 because I kind of like this rectangular grid thing. I set the border to 0.5, and if we had this stuff off, that would look like that. Then I set levels to crush down the alpha, so we mostly just get the dots. And then we have a minimax to make them a little bit bigger, and you can kind of see the faint lines in between. But that was kind of what I wanted it to look like, so that's what I did. Then I put a frame around here. Oh, one thing I didn't mention too is that the line here, the graph itself, has a gradient on the stroke, and it runs basically vertically with the graph. It doesn't go the whole way. It starts like down here and it goes all the way up to like here. So at the top, it's more pink, and at the bottom, it gets more green. Got a similar kind of gradient set up for the frame here. And on top, we have Deep Glow, which is the latest version. And just in case you happen to run into a deal where Deep Glow is like way too bright, I found out that this threshold is kind of like supposed to accept HDR values. I'm not entirely sure about how that works out here because our project is 8-bit. And that should, I would think, stop at 100%, but I found out that at 100%, we're like way too bright on that. So I went to 144. You can keep going a pretty good way. At a certain point, it just pretty much goes away completely, but that was where I liked it, so I left it. And then I had the threshold set to smooth at 50% too. On top of that, I was going to throw a LUT, but I ended up just using Lumetri itself. The LUT I was going to use made it a little too blue for everything, and this kind of stuff in here got too hot, and I kind of like the way the colors were. So I basically just went into creative here and I bumped the shadow up to a little bit of blue just to give it a little bit, because it's pretty neutral to red in here with this. So bumping that up kind of just made it, you know, all come together a little bit. And that's pretty much it. It's how you can get this graph that kind of does this whole deal, or you can, you know, make it changeable based on whatever data you want, or select a different range, or however you want to do it. Being able to bring CSVs into After Effects does a lot of cool stuff for us.
Anyway, that's it. I hope you guys can find a way to put this to good use. If you have any comments or questions, leave them in the comments down below. And if you like this video, make sure to subscribe. If you'd like to help support what we do, check out patreon.com/workbench. Make sure to keep up with the blog at workbench.tv. And as always, I'm Joe, and we'll see you.